Love is in the air. Hey everyone, welcome back to the podcast. We're gonna talk about love and relationships. I've been mulling over your comments. I did two videos on love, emo love and anime love, and how it's impacted my understanding of love. And I wanna talk about today sort of the exploration into love. What does it mean? I've had a lot of really weird relationships. A lot of my 20s was a hot mess. A lot of my 20s was very much dating people who were broken, and I love the emo-ness of that, but we did not grow together. We grew heavily apart. And a lot of that was because of value differences. Now, I in my 20s was interested in dating people with different values because I wanted to be as far away from my family's values as I could because I was coming out of conservatism. I was really resentful. And now that I'm older, I realize I'm a little traditional at heart. Sorry. I want to grow old. I want to be a grandma. I want to have families and generations of kids. And I want to have a pretty traditional relationship. I want to be monogamous now. I think that's what's going to work best with my one chance at existence, mostly because I'm such a, like a very, I don't want to say rigid person, because that's not the word, but I am very, I like my life the way I like my life, and so I kind of think it's going to be hard enough to find one person, let alone seven. This isn't anime, you know, I'm not going to be adopted by a room full of hot vampire boys and girls, like where we can all form an instant family. And I don't know about you, but dating is emotionally cost a lot. So I wanna make sure that when I'm investing my time, I'm investing it in a future that makes sense. So, what is love? And is it love? Were you ever in love if your relationship imploded and you broke up? That's what I've been thinking about. I talked a lot about how my parents mimicked a very healthy relationship. Been together over 30 years, they love each other, it's still spicy, still loving, still laughter. My dad comes home every day from work. My mom and dad work together, but you know, they come home every day from work, sit in their backyard, eat lunch together. They always make sure to spend, you know, in middle of the day together, and then of course at night together. It's very much a tradition for them. If they don't do it, it'd be weird. So, what was my 20s like? Let me tell you, let me run it down for you. My 20s was a hot mess. I dated a lot of people who were nothing like my culture or where I came from, but were interesting and different, and we shared some things, mostly sex and BDSM interests and Disneyland. And so we dated. We dated because it was convenient, comfortable, made sense. But in hindsight, as I look back, I realized no wonder they imploded, and I knew in my gut they would. Literally the three main adult relationships I had in my 20s, I absolutely knew they were gonna implode. But I kept thinking, you know what? Why miss an opportunity? You hear that a lot in culture. Oh, don't deny yourself a date just because you don't want to go on it. Maybe this is your future husband or wife. But to be honest, I think when you do things that are against your gut versus facing a fear, it could be a mistake. And you need to know yourself a little bit to know the difference. What's the difference between I'm afraid to go on this date because I might get my heart broken and I don't wanna go on this date, I'm getting weird vibes from this person, you know? What is the difference? Well, the difference is one is survival and then one is fear of like being embarrassed. You wanna make sure that you're not living your life out of fear of being embarrassed, but you're living your life in a way that maintains your safety. Now, how you do that, at what pace you go at, how that impacts your life, that's on you, boo, and I ain't judging your process. For me, I had to learn a very hard and mean lesson in my 20s about how I loved and who I loved. My siblings and I were together the other day, and my brothers asked, what consequences do we have to face to stop making mistakes? And for me, I have to face a lot of consequences for me to stop making mistakes. I am a pain slut, I'm a masochist. I'm very good with pushing my body and my energy and my emotions to the end of like the brink basically before I come back and examine myself and make better decisions. So I, in hindsight, now that I'm in my 30s, have to be wiser with how I'm interacting with people because I know my shortcomings. So my shortcomings, of course, will always consist of thinking I can save the world, knowing I can give people more than they even assumed they could get, and choosing to engage with people or invite people into my space because I don't give off an air of pushing people away. It invites people into my life of all sorts, and then I have to do a better job at sorting them out. So in my 20s, I remember I was, my 20s were kind of a hot mess, literally, but I was a virgin until I was 22, and I had done some stuff with some people, but when I was 22, I'd worked at a Kroger, and I told everyone, okay, I'm ready to have sex. Who would like to have sex with me? And I am just, I want you to know that I think I am an ogre of a person most days. Like, I think I just, I'm insignificant, and I think that I am cute, but I'm not like a girl who could just walk into a place and get a date, right? I feel like my personality works because I'm very blunt with people. So if I was a quiet girl, I probably would be a virgin until today. You know what I mean? But I'm a loud girl and I'm a persistent girl. And so in my 20s, I basically asked my coworkers if anyone wanted to have sex with me. And I had quite the number of humans that were interested, mostly because they were interested in being my first, which is just like a weird game people play with themselves. I don't really understand the significance of it intellectually, but emotionally, I suppose it could be interesting. So I went down the line of the people who applied, and I chose a person, and I'm glad I chose him. He was definitely the right choice. He was 19, I was 22, he was sweet as beans. He made me a Tool album, like a mix for one of our dates. It was very sweet. I negotiated for a 2-week physical casual relationship, which would allow me to explore the male body. And at the time, I'd been suffering from identity crisis of bisexual or lesbian, because bisexual wasn't really an option growing up for me. People even in the queer community invalidated that existence and made me feel like, oh, is this not possible? But I feel attracted to both, so I'm confused. Well, anyways, I didn't want to go throughout my life without sucking dick, because like, who wants to do that? So we came to a negotiation. I was renting a room at the time. He came to my space. We had 2 weeks of glorious, wonderful, explorative sex. It was amazing. Like, I remember, and this is totally TMI, you can skip the section if you want, but I remember we were naked in bed, and I told him to lay down and get on his back and just let me touch him and put him inside me and figure out what I was gonna do, what the limitations of my body was. So he did that. It was my first experience realizing like, oh, I might be switchy, but never processing it, because I was already in BDSM at this time. I was already going to dungeons at this time. I was just virginal, and he was vanilla, but he was also kinky, and he wanted to explore with me. And so we have sex, we go through our adventures. It's like 2 weeks of fun. You know, we had been friends and coworkers, so we'd done a bunch of stuff together already, Disneyland and hanging out and going to Denny's and doing all the weird things you do in your early 20s. And then at the end of the 2 weeks, I shook his hand and thanked him for his time and said, okay, I'm good. And he was shooketh. He was like, wait, what? And I was like, wait, what? And he thought for some reason that we were going to end up dating. He was like, I just thought you were talking. And I was like, what do you mean? He goes, well, you know, girls say that, like, oh, I'm not loose, I'm not going to sleep with you. And like, and, you know, oh, like, I'm casual, or, you know, whatever it was, whatever facade a girl had told him, I apparently contradicted it. And I told him, I'm sorry, like, I really think I know what I want, and I don't think we should be engaging. Well, let me tell you, it was very messy afterwards, and for like a couple months, he was very upset with me and passively, aggressively get upset. And honestly, as I've gotten older, I'm not even mad at him. I think I understood at the time why. Like, we had a really good time together. We liked the same music. We liked hanging out. You know, we hung out together. I liked his family. Why wouldn't we date? Well, because I knew in my gut it wasn't going to go anywhere. I knew ultimately we weren't compatible. And that was the last time I trusted my goddamn gut for like 6 years. Idiot. Like, that was the last time I trusted my gut. And I knew better. Like, I knew. And then what happened was, a few weeks after that, he started to tell people some stories, you know, because he was bragging. And I would roll my eyes at this. But it's like super important, I guess, for like bonding time, that people like talk about their sexcapades. It was for me, like, I had all my besties I went to, and I was like, I got laid. You know, he just did it with a lot of coworkers, so people would come up to me and talk to me about it. I ended up becoming such a, like, a controversial figure in the store, because I was such a hoe. Like, I just did not care, you know what I mean? Like, it was Kroger, everyone relaxed, acting like it's a real job. So anyways, the job I was doing was not a real job. I wasn't a manager or anything. I was like a nobody. So anyways, there was a girl though we worked with, and she and I at first were mortal enemies, just like hated each other. And then over time, we started to become more cool with each other, just like figured out a way for us not to fight all the time. But then, he talked to her and he told her some stuff we did in bed. So one day she runs up to me. She's like, Brittany. And I'm like, yes. And she's like, I heard. And I was like, you heard what? And she's like, I heard what you like in bed. And I was like, and I looked at the guy that I'd been having sex with, and I shook my head at him, and I was like, what did you hear? She goes, I heard you like to have a belt around your neck and to be choked during sex. And I was like, this is a fact. It is true. I do like this. And and I am more of an edge player. So the thing that was significantly interesting to her, and she said this, she goes, you know what I realized? And I was like, what? She goes, he told me you guys didn't put a lock on the belt buckle. And I was like, yes. And I was like, she's like, so when he was fucking you, basically every time he pulled on the belt to thrust inside you, it really choked you. And I was like, yes. And she was like, you know what that means? And I was like, what? And she goes, I think you were in the community. And I was like, the community? And at the time, BDSM was very underground. My mentor had brought me in, and you did not even share FetLife accounts. You were very private, and you did not ask people if they were in BDSM. You used code words. And I was like, community? What do you mean community? Which one? And she goes, you know, the lifestyle. And I was like, the lifestyle? And she goes, the lifestyle. And we looked at each other for a hot second, and I was like, the leather and whip lifestyle? She's like, that one. And then we figured out we were actually, I was in the San Diego scene, she was in the LA scene. We ended up being a part of the BDSM community. We instantly clicked harder because, of course, at the time I wanted to date a woman. She was a switch. I was a bottom, not realizing I would be a switch one day. And it was perfect. We started dating. It was a very awesome relationship for the time that it lasted, but we knew, or at least I did. And I think she did too, to be honest, because it ended so well. We knew we came from different values and backgrounds, and the things that we were connecting on were superficial. Dating just because you're both into BDSM is superficial, but it happens all the time. 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 Because it's already a minority community. Your chances of meeting someone you connect with who's also BDSM is very low. Like, I recognize I'll probably be single for the rest of my life. Because not only am I a completely just absurd human, but I'm also into this BDSM thing that for me is very important. I don't know how to have vanilla sex, people. I am so afraid to do it. I have a vanilla former lover who hit me up and he was like, yo, I want to have sex. And I was like, yo, I don't think I know how to do that anymore. And I'm nervous. Like, I'm nervous to have vanilla sex. Like, I don't know what that's like. It's been over a decade, you know, since the first guy I ever had sex with. And even him, he was kinky. Like, he wasn't BDSM, but he was kinky, you know? He let me do all the weird stuff with him, for sure. Like, oh my God. We were just, it was a very, oh God. Like, some of our memories together were just so ridiculous. Like, yeah, we definitely pushed the boundaries of, like, what was appropriate, I suppose. But we had so much fun. So, anyways, I'm dating this girl, and a lot of you guys have heard me talk about her, but she came from a really racist background. Her dad, single dad, her mom, I think, passed, if I recall. He was really racist, but he also, like, liked me. So I would go over all the time, and I'd be like, hey, hey, hey. And I do this with everyone. When I'm pulling a power move, my power move is to flirt with people because it disarms them, especially if they're people that are, like, extremely hateful. Oh, those are my favorite people to flirt with because it makes them realize, like, I'm the thing most people hate. And most of the minority things that people have been uncomfortable with over the years, I'm all of them. I'm Middle Eastern. I'm queer. I'm BDSM. I'm a heathen. I'm a sex worker. Like, I'm all the things. I'm a druggie. Like, well, I smoke pot. Everyone relax. You know, and acid. And I like, you know, I'm going to do DMT soon. So it's like all these other things. But you know what I mean? I'm a type of person that traditionally people are like, ugh, like too weird, right? But for whatever reason, if I flirt my way into life, it seems to work out. And I do that all the time because I think there's a safety in sex and relationships that used to exist that doesn't exist anymore. Now we've shifted molds where people who catcall you or flirt with you could be a predator automatically. And that's not good because though people are dying and though the statistics are pretty high, they're still not high enough to be paranoid all the time. But I lived in a lack of paranoia. Then I got paranoid when I lived in Seattle because those statistics were always ranted at me. And I was like, oh my God, 1 in 4, 1 in 4, 1 in 4, 1 in 4. But that's not my life experience. I've only been raped once by 2 people. Like once though, once. And all of my escapades and all of my drunk, you know, running around town, all of the catcallers I flirted with all the people who followed me in stores, with all the times I've confronted men and women, I've only been assaulted once. That's pretty good. Like, that's pretty good. Like, statistically, that's pretty good. And for me, at this stage in my existence, my assault is sort of equal to a bar fight a guy gets into with unknowingly and then ends up paralyzed in the hospital or something to that extent. It's like, it's a bad thing that happened. It wasn't consensual, but it's also like a form of animalistic like evolution that I think some humans are experiencing. It's like a power move. And I'm at a place right now where I'm really at peace with it. So I see it very equal to, yes, I was assaulted at one point in my life, but I'm not being assaulted right now. And I most certainly do not, no longer have the anxieties that I had when I was dealing with recovering from my trauma. So I was dating this girl, and over time it became completely clear we had different values when it came to dating. She was still kind of living in the racism of her father's beliefs, the confusion of her own mental illness, and then the dynamics of her BDSM relationship. And over time, we ended up having a moment where she had to move for her job, and I was going to move away, and she offered me to live in a cage under her bed, and I declined. But we had IHOP and went to Disneyland. We had our last date together. We hugged each other, wished each other the best life, and I haven't talked to her since, but I hope that her life is good. But I looked at that relationship and I tried something that I knew wasn't gonna work because it was convenient in there. In 2012, I moved to Seattle, and it was the end of 2012, and I ended up flirting with a guy that I was living with because it was one of those situations where we were all roommates in a house, but no one knew each other. And so there was a guy there, and I thought he was cute, and I was horny, and so I decided to flirt to see how he would react. And my way of flirting is very simple, very cash, very like conservative. I depending on the person. But with him, I chose to do the bend over and snap, you know, Legally Blonde. So if he was in the kitchen making food, I would like bend over in the fridge and get some milk and snap up and do one of these. And then if he reacted or seemed positive about it or looked at me for a long time, I would take that as a sign to move forward in my flirtation. And then I'd be more aggressive. And then one thing led to another. And finally, I just kind of went, so are we gonna have sex, you know, and like had that conversation. And during this time, I was a very avoidant person. I wanted to fall in love, but I also had a lot of walls and a lot of trauma I was dealing with. And so with him, I put up a huge wall because I knew I didn't want to date him. I found out too much about him over time that made me realize like, oh my God, you're not even a good person. But I was being selfish and horny and I just wanted to engage. And I think this is so important because I wanted to engage. I wanted to engage. And these relationships in the world where there's so much going on, where people are so convinced that in toxic relationships, there must always be a victim or something else. We forget, like, sometimes we do things against our own health because we want to. And I definitely am one of those people who, like, in my 20s, I did that a lot. And I learned through discipline how not to do those things. That's why I'm so obsessed with it. Discipline, it's such a good thing for me. But anyways, so I'm seeing this guy, and we're having sex, and eventually, it was January. It was the new year. They were doing the polar bear plunge in Seattle, where we all get up at ass crack in the morning and go jump in a river full of fucking cold ass water. And I was sitting in my apartment in front of this huge window watching the sun come up with him, and we were talking about our lives. And we had just been casual by then, and we weren't really too intimate or personal until that night. And that morning, we were sitting down in two chairs side by side. And he's like, just to give an image, he's like a tall, skinny, 6'4 guy who's in his late 30s. And I'm this small 5'1, 115 pound, 20 something year old. And we're sitting there and he's asking me about my life. And I'm giving him kind of short, curt answers. And then he goes, would you care if I left right now? And I said, not in particular, should I care if you leave right now? And he goes, well, I kind of like the idea of you wanting me to stay. And I was like, oh, well, I don't care if you stay. And that's the honest to God truth. Like, I could lie to you and tell you that I care, but I don't. Like, I'm not attached to you. And he goes, really? Even after everything we've been doing? And I said, yeah, I don't feel that attached to you. Like, I'm so glad you're here. I'm having fun with you. But if you leave, I'll just go about my day. We get in a little bit of a fight and we go back and forth because he's upset that I don't want him. And I'm trying to figure out, why would you, we're fuck buddies, we're not dating, like, what is the big deal? We have a functionality, we can be friends and lovers, I don't know why you're trying to be more than that. Things kind of go back and forth, there's a little bit of, like, bitterness in the way we're talking, and then finally, we end up cuddling on the floor. I'm being spooned by him. It's silent in the house, my roommate's asleep, the sun is up, and we're just talking, we're waiting to leave for the polar bear plunge, and we're talking. As he holds me in his arms and presses me against him, he starts to tell me about his childhood. And it was a really bad childhood. As he spoke about his life, I burst into tears. And I couldn't stop crying. He turns me around, looks me in the eye, cuddling my face, and he says to me, "No one has ever cried for me." And I cried harder. To be in a position in existence where no one has seen you and cried for your pain, that's so hard. And to be in your late 30s and to have never have had that, and I was heartbroken. Now, over time, I realized it was harder to cry for his pain because he was a bad person. And I think what really happened was he was showing me so many of his quote-unquote good parts that I forgave the mishappings that had occurred in our entanglement. I decided to date him because I cried, so we were connected. And for 2 years, it was an up and down relationship where I learned a lot of what a toxic relationship really looks like. And I had an idea of how to avoid this particular kind of person. But the relationship I got into next was even more toxic, but that was because I really fell in love. Like, I thought I was in love with the 30-something-year-old guy, but this other guy, like, I was in love. Like, he and I went down such a rabbit hole of intimacy, of bonding, of self-sabotage, that it felt like we were connected in a way that was so important. Now, of course, in that relationship, it was the hardest one I had to deal with. There was cheating and lying and consequences that were more than I wish I had to experience. But I was so in love. I was so determined and so in love to make this work that I self-sabotaged so hard. And going back to that question my siblings asked about, like, what consequences are we willing to have for the things we want? Well, girl, like, consequences be out the window, you know? I was just a hot mess. So that relationship ended. And the number one question I had to answer was that ever real love? And for me, it was. I was deeply in love. I was foolishly in love. I was passionately in love. I was greedily in love. I was possessive. I was hopeful. I was naive. I was everything. And in turn, I allowed my mind to be used as a punching bag. I allowed my patience to be overused. I allowed and chose to be in that relationship. Like, I chose it over and over and over again. I'm not an idiot. I'm not a stupid person. I know that I had consensually engaged in a toxic relationship in hopes that this relationship would somehow end up better, because everyone I have ever dated has had a horrible childhood. And I started to date people, I think, who had horrible childhoods because I thought they had ones like mine, but they didn't. Because to be completely honest, mine had moments, but it wasn't long. My suffering as a child only lasted so long. And it wasn't in any way truly in relation to how these people had suffered. I mean, these people dealt with parents with drug addiction and cheating and lying and awful things. I never experienced that. My parents are still together. There was never drugs in the house. My parents are good people. Like, they didn't have a past that was full of, like, huge struggle. They had what I call Christian, like, Catholic, scandalous issues. Like, they were rebels, or maybe they didn't follow the traditions of the Middle Eastern culture. They were those kind of rebels. Or my parents didn't know how to react to the fact that I was queer. Like, those things were a struggle. And my parents did things that were definitely unorthodox, but they were never intentionally malicious or bad people, and they still aren't. They're really great people. So I realized over time I was dating people that I thought had my shared culture and background, and they didn't. And so that was the big issue as well. When I was seeking out love, I was seeking out love that was different from how I was raised, without understanding that that was my sabotage. My sabotage was thinking that I had come from such a broken home when I really hadn't. And that was because of trauma, and I just couldn't see clearly. And I couldn't see clearly for most of my life. Like, I saw others pretty clearly. But I didn't see my own shortcomings at all. Like, I suffered greatly by not understanding that though my arrogance helped me survive the streets, it did not help me survive the political, social expectations of moving up the ladder of social hierarchies. Like, I'm very bad at, like, I got kicked out of cotillion and nun camp. Do you guys know what cotillion is? It's just like that stupid thing people do. I don't even know why I did it, except my friends were doing it and they were like, Brittany, come with us. And like, girls and boys waltz together and then you learn how to do like fine dining and like what fork goes where and what spoon goes where. And I'm just like, oh my God, like literally kill me. And I remember I showed up and I tried to lead the dance with the boy. They did not like that. I crossed my legs when I was sitting and they're like, women don't cross their legs like that. Ladies do this and this and this. And I was like, guess I'm not a lady. I was just like, I'm not a very good pretender for too long. I can pretend for some time, but I get very bored pretending that I care about what spoon goes where. Which is very funny because in BDSM, I'm all about that protocol and all about those rules. I know, the contradictions. Guys, let's go ahead and take a break and we'll be right back.
Hi, hello. Are you a loser who spends all their time on the computer pondering their own existence? Me too! Join us on Patreon for just a dollar to meet hundreds of people who are exactly like you, or nothing like you, or somewhat like you. On Patreon for just a dollar, you'll have access to live shows, collaborations, and conversations. Oh, and of course, photo shoots of me looking like a hoe. So join us there and enjoy the ride. Thanks, bye!
One of the frustrations I've really had with culture is how shallow our introspection is. Twilight is back in the air and everyone is talking about it again. And I'm very excited. I have Midnight Sun in my closet. I'm gonna start reading it. I'm very stoked. I remember a time when I was reading Twilight and people would make fun of me in high school because, oh my God, why are you reading that book? It's so big. And then I swear to God, a year later, everyone was reading it. And I remember thinking like, great, now I'll have people to talk to about this thing. But everyone got different things from those stories. For me, it was the thrill of finding somebody who just understood you, or the idea of somebody who was asleep for over 100 years and their heart awakened by somebody else. But as the story ended up getting torn apart and feminists came out of the woodworking to talk about how toxic it was, one of the conversations that often occurred, which really at one point sounded good to me and now I'm just like dumb, is the idea that like, oh, Edward's in his hundreds, you know, and he's into this teenage girl. He's basically a pedophile. Yes. If you look at it outside of lore, it's why I love anime. All the guys that girls fall in love with or vice versa, they're like ancient vampires or like ancient orgs or ancient whatever. Everyone's living at different times or in different ways. It's not meant to be literal. Humans can't live that long. It's meant to be explorative. What does it mean to love? Is there an idea, a concept that the person you're supposed to be with could maybe not exist just yet? I talked about age gap relationships in one of my stories where I told you, you know, my family friend would often ask in his 20s, like, where is my wife? Well, she was in middle school. They were quite an age gap, I think like 14 years. So it's one of those things where when we think about what is perversion, what is abuse, what is love, we have to be able to really agree that these things can overlap, but they're different. I know a lot of people who they would say, like, if we were to examine a relationship, they might say, oh, that's abusive. And I would say, nope, that's just a person throwing a tantrum. Because for me, a lot of people, a lot of humans are stunted. And so when I see them and they react poorly, I'm able to process that, oh, you are throwing a tantrum versus you are a threat to my life. One time, and I remember because this is the day that I fell in love with my last relationship, or not fell in love, but I decided I would pursue them and date them. Because I'd been denying him. I'd been denying everyone. Everyone that's ever pursued me, I knew they weren't right, right? I haven't dated anyone yet that's been healthy, and that makes sense. I think given my life, it makes sense that I haven't had relationships that were meant to last. Instead, I had relationships in which we learned from each other and grew, because that can happen in your 20s. So I remember this instance where I had gone to the bathroom. We were hosting a game night and it was like the bunch of BDSM people. I had come out of the bathroom and there was tension in the air. Like I hadn't even entered the game space yet. And I was like, uh-oh, something happened when I was in the bathroom. I walked into the space and everyone was almost like frozen, like scared. And I was like, what happened? And two of the girls had gone into it. It was like a personal relationship, and one person had bitten the other person too hard, as one does in a BDSM setting, and they could tell that the bite was done maliciously, and so they got into a fist fight over it. It was very interesting, and I'm sad I missed the literal when it happened, but the person at the time that I would eventually date, he tore them up, put them down, calmed everybody down, and got the situation under control. And I remember thinking, like, I loved it, because in that moment, he showed his father's side, which only existed as a facade. But it was enough for me to go, oh, you can handle shit when it goes down. Okay, I'll think about it. Because I am the person who is always called upon when shit goes down. I am the person that travels to see my friends, that travels to see my family. I'm the first person to get on a plane. I'm a person who will take off work. I am a person who, when people need something, they usually do come to me. And that's fine. That makes sense. I'm following the mother trope of my existence, so I accept this. But it also means that I use it as a judgment on whether or not I would date somebody, their ability to take care of a situation when things go wrong, because girl, I'm tired. I don't always want to be the person everyone relies on. Like, I need a break too. So this fight broke out. Everything got calmed down. We were laying in bed hours later, and I looked at him and said, okay, I'll go out with you. And he goes, really? And I go, yeah. I go, I'm not in love with you, but I will go out with you. I think the way you handled tonight was really good. And that was a mistake. Just because he handled one thing appropriately doesn't mean that made him all of a sudden better. But for some reason in my brain, I was waiting for him to prove to me he could handle things and he could be reliable. So then over the span of like 2, 3, 4 years, a whole 5 years, I think, in conclusion, we had been interacting because we're no longer in contact. I'm not interested in being in contact. I absolutely want nothing to do with my past. I let that Brittany die. I'm no longer that Brittany. That this Brittany now would not be very, what's the word? I don't want to say kind, but I think this Brittany would be very bored with her past coming back to talk to her. Because it just seems pathetic now, like childish, to be frank, because it was super childish. So the idea that I would still be a person who would want to engage in that childishness is just like offensive to my growth. So anyways, at the time I learned that he had problems with the childhood, pathological liar, blamed everyone for his problems, and I kept blaming everyone for his problems too. I fed into it. That toxicity we have when we love is the blinders we put on for the people that we love. And in turn, the blinders we put on to protect ourselves. If, you know, people would tell me all the time, like, this is an abusive relationship. And I'm like, don't tell me what it is and isn't, because I don't feel like I'm being abused, because I know what's happening. I know he's a liar. I know he's a person who doesn't follow the rules. I know he's a person who didn't break my consent in the way that you're thinking. Like, he wasn't predatory in the sense that, like, I ever was assaulted by him or anything like that. I, you know, nothing like that. Definitely moments where we crossed lines, but not moments where, like, I ever felt like this was a dangerous person. And that's the thing. For me, for someone to be dangerous to me, they would have to be dangerous to me. Like, I remember when I was dating the guy who was over 6 feet, my dad asked me, he goes, Batsy, has he ever hit you? And I go, what? Me? Hit me? And I was really offended at that idea, because, like, no bitch ever hits me. No one ever hits me. You want to fucking try to hit me, you can go the fuck ahead, because I am, in terms of personality, I'm aggressive. Like, people do not hit me. Like, I will take a motherfucker down. And that's the problem, is that my lived experience is not going to be the same as everyone else's. Maybe if I was a wallflower or quiet or whatever else, maybe, but I'm a loud person that suffered from anxiety and PTSD and all these things. I'm a aggressive woman that suffered from these things. So my outlet was not passivity. My outlet was, excuse me? Like, I remember even, and all the moments, and this is why I say, like, I'm really anti people just automatically being like, this is abusive. Because abuse to me is a big deal. It's not that I wasn't abused. It was that I don't feel the emotions I think I should feel if this is abuse. I feel mostly like, okay, I can see the damage. It's like I was having sex with a rattlesnake and it bit me and everyone's like, abuse. And I'm like, but it's a rattlesnake. It's not, it is what it is. Like, I dated a rattlesnake. And I think that's how I feel with all these women in media right now. Shia LaBeouf, Armie Hammer, and Marilyn Manson. It's like, I know, looking at them, I know their history as actors. And I already know, like, Britney, I'm like, ooh, I could make those guys really happy because I'm a freak. But they would make me miserable because they're crazy. They're totally just out of control with their desires. All three of them have issues with drug abuse and violence. All three of them create works of art that I love and I can absolutely separate from the artist. I love Shia LaBeouf's work. I think he's a very interesting human, but I don't need to date him. Okay? And I already know that because, like, I don't got time for his drama. Same with Armie Hammer, same with Marilyn Manson. The issue I'm having with media and the way we're talking about these relationships is these women who are completely turning themselves into 100% victims. And I'm like, I'm sorry. Like, at some point, you're either smart enough and have enough agency to be an adult or you don't. I don't know in the real world if there is a separation of this. And in childhood, we tell our kids people should be nice and we try to raise children to be good participants in society. But we also need to make them aware that, like, life also sucks and people you love could be hurting you and you need to be ready to stand up against those people. But also you have to be able to, like, be aware that you chose it to some extent. Choosing your future, choosing what you do today and tomorrow is literally your ultimate form of power. Your free will is your ultimate mode of power. And when you don't use it, it frustrates me. And I understand that people were frustrated with me when I was in my toxic relationships because they looked at me and said, exercise your free will. And I was like, I am. I'm doing it in the bad way though. I'm exercising my free will. And I am doing that, and I know people didn't like the way I did it, but the way I did it was to go to the end of the bridge until I could absolutely go no more. So for me, the reason I kept taking back my ex-boyfriend was I wasn't finished. The vanity of my brain to think that I could save him wasn't finished. I had to get so fucked. I had to get so fucking fucked for me to realize, oh, my therapist was right. You really cannot save people. I mean, this is a person who had literally handouts, resources, support groups, everything you could use to combat the whole, well, maybe if they were just loved differently. But that's not what it's about. Sometimes, yes. But other times, no. And so we need to, when engaging in love, learn the differences between those things. When is it toxic? When is it not good? When are you aware it's toxic but you're still engaging? When are you in control? It's exactly like any good anime story, anything else. You always have a character who's broken and needs help, and sometimes they get better and sometimes they don't, but they have to do it on their own. As much as anime pushes the narrative that your friends cause you to be a better person, it really isn't true. If you watch an anime and really pay attention to the story, the person who is the bad person still has to choose to get better, which is why ultimately there's still bad guys in the world of anime, because there are, in real life, ultimately bad people, and they're not always the people you think they are. I've been called a bad person. I know you've probably been called a bad person. When we examine ourselves, there are definitely moments in our life when we're not engaging in the healthiest way and we're engaging in bad behavior. I don't think that defines all of us for the rest of our life. And I don't think even the worst of us can be defined forever. But I do think some of us choose to continue being defined by our worst traits. And if that's a choice you want to make, exercising your free will, I will give you the respect you're asking for, which is to be seen and recognized for what you are, a bad person. Versus somebody who's really trying and just kind of shitty at it. I really love love, and I love talking about it, and I love exploring it, and I really want to hear your thoughts. I want to go ahead and talk more about, or not talk more, no, I want to be introspective more about how we truly self-sabotage our own relationships by not being honest with how we examine ourselves. And I don't mean in the stupid wokeness political way of like ownership and responsibility, because God knows none of you guys are taking responsibility for your bullshit. So I don't mean in that way. I mean in a true way, like, who are you as a human? Who are you? And what are you fucking doing with your life? What am I doing? What are any of us doing that makes us wake up every day and say, I'm living a good life. Like, I'm living the right life. Like, are we Diogenes living in fields of, you know, sunshine and flowers, drinking from the cups of our hands, experiencing life in the most, you know, sort of like humble, narcissistic way? Because, like, there is sort of an arrogance to that, right? But also a desire to be so away from the world. And then a sort of balance of loving the world. Like, me even consuming emo music or, you know, superficial animes or whatever else I'm consuming sometimes. Not that all animes are superficial. We must understand that some of them are deep meat. But anyways, I don't want to talk about it. there are moments in our lives where we have to find these balances. And I think in America, because a romance is pushed so hard, we put all of it in that. But it's not what it's for. That is not what it's for. So you have to come to terms with, what is your romance for? Why do you want to fall in love? And why do you want to be in a couple? I know some of you are poly, but just bear with me. Why do you want to date someone? Because if it's to avoid being alone, that's, I don't know that that's healthy. And I definitely wouldn't want to date somebody who told me that they only wanted to date somebody because they didn't want to grow old alone or because it's about them. I don't want to date somebody because it's all about me. I want to date somebody because I found another human being that I respect and love and want to be honored with them in my life and vice versa. I want to look at somebody and go, wow, like you're fucking dope. Do you want to grow old with me and watch my tits sag? And then I want it to be, yeah, do you want to watch me grow old? And you know, something beautiful. All right, I'm gonna go because I am so hungry right now and my stomach is growling and I need to eat something. But I also need to make this podcast so I could get it out earlier than later. It is Wednesday. I'm doing this on the same day you'll see it. I hope it is good. I'm sure there are problems. I'm sure there are things I could have mentioned. But I do think this is a place to start, a question to ask ourselves. I did want to go harder into cinema, talking about like Moulin Rouge and Romeo and Juliet and all these things, but I just don't think it's necessary. I think you guys get the idea of what I'm going for here, and I'm so glad we could do this today. Please let me know what you think. If I feel so inspired and motivated, I'll put out a podcast maybe at different times, but otherwise I'll see you next Wednesday. I hope you have a great day. Please check out our Patreon at a dollar level. We just had a live show. It was really nice the other day. We do more live shows on Patreon than we do on YouTube. So if that's something you guys want to join us, check it out. And I'm going to go. Talk to you soon. Bye.
Stuck in my head, in real life I'm in bed. My belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine. Not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed. So why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking. Yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth and living life as a fool. Dun, dun, dun.